evening, ladies and gentlemen, distinguished guests. It's the fate of the last speaker that he or she is invariably bitten by the dogs. I'm very sorry about this because my lecture was supposed to start at 7 o'clock, but the end of today's meeting was also at 7 o'clock. So I had about 30 seconds for my presentation, which is a bit short. My point of view, I'm not a politician. I'm not representing any kind of tourist agency. I'm an academic, so my approach to nation branding will be slightly different, but I hope that I can combine a few ideas that have been around here this afternoon about the Brexit and the future of Europe and many other aspects in my presentation. As you've just heard, I've been responsible for a study program at my university, which is called International Cultural and Business Studies. We train our students at the interface of business studies, marketing particularly on the one hand, and on cultural studies on the other. And that interface often has to do frequently with consumer products, like, for instance, the new BMW Mini. The new Mini has been relaunched 2 years ago, and BMW knows that you cannot have one branding campaign for this particular product because you have to brand it differently in Italy, in the States, and elsewhere. So you must know the country if you would like to put your product onto a market. And that is something that we try to train our students in, that they learn how to deal with a certain country when it comes to business studies. I'm not talking about the relation between cultural studies and economics. That is a long tradition dating back to Adam Smith, The Wealth of Nations. But I'm talking about business studies and marketing and cultural studies. So what I'm trying to do with you in the last few minutes is, this is my agenda. I would like to introduce you to what is moving me in the field of nation branding, because fortunately many of our graduates have found places and openings in this field of branding nations, branding regions, and branding cities, because there's an increasing competition between cities, regions, and nations. So I'm interested in this interface between business studies and cultural studies. I take Scotland as my case study, but you will see that my ideas hopefully reach a bit farther than just Scotland. A small nation, but much depends in terms of the UK, in terms of Europe, and perhaps globally, on the future of this small country, 3.5 million people. Scotland is particularly close to me. I work in Bavaria, and within the Europe of regions, Bavaria and Scotland are twinned regions, and we are running a number of joint programs with Scotland. So I'm very often in Scotland, and I'm very concerned about the future of the country. I would like to say a few words about the theory of nation branding. I don't know whether that has been tackled. I couldn't hear all of the presentations here, but I heard most of them, and I haven't heard a lot about the theory of nation branding, the methods of nation branding, how this is actually being done. And then I would like to look at four campaigns with you. Number one was Scotland the Brand. As you can see, it ran for 10 years, which is the minimum for a successful branding campaign. Then 6.2 and 6.3 were small campaigns, A Smart Successful Scotland and Scotland the Best Small Country in the World. Both of them were a waste of money because you can't run a campaign for a country for 2 years. That's far too short. We have to think in terms of 10, 20, perhaps 30 years in order to increase the reputation of a country. And the last one is now Scotland's economic strategy for the last 10 years, and that has proved rather well, as you will see. Better than the short-lived campaigns. And in concluding, I would like to take a parting glance at the question of nation branding, of national identity. You may remember Scotland is moving towards an independent nation, and what national independence might mean for European architecture. Branding came into being about the middle of the 1990s, and Wally Ollins, who unfortunately died 2 years ago, was one of the founding fathers of this idea of branding. And in a book which he published in 2003 with the title On Brand, he said, "Brands and the idea of branding are the most significant gifts that commerce has ever made to popular culture." And that is the interface I mean, between commerce, business studies, the economy on the one hand, and cultural studies on the other, between culture and business. He was the founding father of nation branding, and nation branding, meanwhile, has moved out of its infancy. It's now a very grown-up business form of doing business. Nation branding, then my second part, is the interface, as I said, between business studies and cultural studies. And Keith Dinney, a Scotsman, published a book in 2008 on nation branding concepts, issues, and practice. And he wrote in the introduction, "National identity plays a key role in nation branding. And awareness and understanding of the core features of national identity is a prerequisite for developing nation branding campaigns, as the essence of any nation brand derives not only from the country's companies and brands, but also from its culture in the widest sense, language, literature, music, sport, architecture, and so on, all embody the soul of a nation. This is one reason why nation branding is too large an undertaking to be left solely to marketing, branding, or advertising people." And I think that is true. You need business people, marketing people, but you also need people who are knowledgeable about the country, the region, the city that is supposed to be marketed. That brings me to Scotland, to my case study. Scotland is a nation, as I would like to show you, but it is not a state. It's not independent. In figure one, you see the results of the referendum on Scottish independence, which was held on the 18th of September in 2014. And as we've seen earlier on, many Western societies are torn almost in the middle. You see this here, sorry. You see this here as well. The red is the no. No, we don't want to be an independent country. 55%, almost 45% said, yes, we would like to be an independent country. Again, you see this rift in the Brexit, to which I will come presently, and you also see it in the American elections. It's a bit worrying that many, many Western societies are so 50-50, in a way, broken in the middle. So this votum, this referendum on Scottish independence, failed in 2014, and the reasons are, why did it fail? Why was the Scottish electorate not willing to go the way for independence? This 18th September was very well chosen, 18th September 2014, because it was 700 years, exactly on the day, after the Scottish victory, the last great Scottish victory, over the English army at Bannockburn. This is a historical map where Bannockburn is located. You can see north of Glasgow and west of Edinburgh. And one of the great heroes in the Scottish past was Robert the Bruce. You see him here proudly standing on horseback. And Robert the Bruce, and do you know any second great Scottish hero? Mel Gibson in Blue and White, in Braveheart, you remember? And Robert the Bruce followed Braveheart. These are the great Scottish heroes at the moment. You know, they're really, really, really celebrated. So 700 years after the battle, the victorious battle of Bannockburn, this referendum was held. Scotland then, as I said, is a nation, but it's not a state. In 1603, Queen Elizabeth died, the good Queen Elizabeth, the great English queen, the Queen of Shakespeare, and the crown at the time went to James VI of Scotland, because Elizabeth was never married, she had no children, the Tudor line died out with her, and James VI of Scotland became James I of England. He was the son of Mary Stuart. And in 1707, not only the crowns were united, but both parliaments were united. In 1707, the Act of Union with England was passed, and England and Scotland together at the time became Britain. This is important these days for the Scottish National Party, because they believe they want to keep the Queen. Yeah? They want to revoke the 1707 Act of Union, which combined both parliaments. They want to have separate parliaments, but they want to keep the Queen, because the Queen, the present Queen, the Union of Crowns was passed in 1603, which is a stupid thing to do if you want to become independent and keep the Queen. So the end of political sovereignty occurred through the dissolution of the Scottish Parliament. The Scottish Parliament was lost in 1707 in Edinburgh. And in 1997, a referendum on devolution was passed. And with the Scotland Act in 1998, Scotland became its own parliament again. But it is not an autonomous, not an independent parliament. It's a devolved parliament with certain rights. However, Scotland is not a nation, but it is certainly not a state, but certainly a nation. Scotland has an autonomous civic society with a strong local government. It has kept its own legal system, which is similar to the European system, whereas England uses common law, Scotland uses canonized law. It has an independent Church of Scotland, the Kirk in religious terms, an independent system of education. The school system, the university system in Scotland is different from England and Wales, always was. It has an autonomous media scene, there's BBC Scotland for television, there's the New Statesman as one of the leading newspapers, and there's a great sense of national history and national pride. At the moment, the first minister, as the Prime Minister in Scotland is called, is Nicola Sturgeon, born in 1970, and she said, "For my part, and I believe for my generation, I have never doubted that Scotland is a nation." And I think that's true. Scotland is not a state, but a nation. So my propositions are the following. In 2014, Scotland's national identity, I would argue, was not sufficiently strengthened to convince a majority of the population of the country's political independence. The strategies of branding Scotland as an autonomous political state had failed marginally, 45 to 55. What are then the consequences for Scotland's future? Scotland's future in the light of the Brexit. What are the consequences for the United Kingdom and indeed for the European Union, for European political architecture? And do we want Scotland's political independence at all? Do we want the country to be independent, or should we rather suggest them not to do that? And this brings me to number four, to the theory of nation branding. What does nation branding try to do? It is basically the transfer of marketing strategies for consumer goods, for Coca-Cola, for Nike running shoes, for BMW, to the reputation of a nation or a country, but also to regions and cities. Many people have felt you can't really do that. What you do to Coca-Cola, you can't do that to Scotland or to Honduras or whatever. Many people feel that. So that is why some people said, well, it's not really nation branding. It's called competitive identity, to bring up an identity of a certain area and to show that you are in competition with other countries. So competitive identity perhaps might be the better term. So the idea of nation branding, it aims at improving both the internal self-perception of the people, how the people themselves in a country feel within that nation or country, and the external perception of that nation or country. How do other nations see that particular nation? How is that nation being ranked and rated? And you will see the strategies of rating in a minute. So the major goal is then to improve the internal and external reputation of a nation or country, and we've just heard Honduras and Uruguay, they're all going into that particular direction. The model at the time was Cool Britannia. Don't know if you remember that 20 years ago when Tony Blair was first elected, there was this idea of Cool Britannia, of new Labour, not the old Labour Party of the working class, but a new Labour Party. Britain as the new centre of popular music, fashion, design, the media, Britpop. Remember the Union Jack in a new sort of design, you know, not the old imperial Union Jack, but something new, something fresh, something that would also be sexy, erotic, vibrant, with loads of music, with Oasis and Blur and the other Britpop groups that in the 1990s became so popular. And Tony Blair liked to show himself off with the members of Oasis and other bands. So that is the idea. Try to treat a nation, a region, a city, just as you would treat a consumer's product. What are the methods? How do you do it? The leading figure at the moment in that market is a man called Simon Anholt, an American who has become the strategic expert, basically, on nation branding. And he developed what he calls a nation brand hexagon. And this nation brand hexagon, that is six factors, are important for measuring and for ranking the reputation of a country. If we start clockwise at 9 o'clock, the most important thing are the people. How do people from other nations think about the people in our target nation? Are these people seen as friendly, welcoming, warm-hearted, cheery, or are they cold, repellent? How do other people think about one's own people? Tourism. Is the country attractive for tourists? Do people like to go there? Is it a place where you would say, this is vibrant, this is where I would like to go? And we've seen Honduras and Uruguay, how they try to show off their assets, how, why the country could be interesting. Exports. Has the country any interesting products that come from that country? Something is called the country of origin effect, that if a product comes from a certain country, you would rank the country higher because I have got a Samsung. I don't know what you've got. But Samsung, Kia, has rated South Korea rather high now, not North Korea necessarily. Fourth, governance. Is it a stable? Am I in despair? What are you doing back there? Oh, John. Can you somehow? I mean, I've waited all night. Oh. Very well done, thank you, yes. My poor heart. Governance. Is the country politically stable? Is it reliable? Is it a stable political country? Yeah, that is important. Or do you fear, if you go there, that you might get into dangers or difficulties, whatever? Five, investment and immigration. Is it a safe place for you to invest your money in? Would you be willing to build a factory there? Do you think the workforce is well trained? Do you find interesting people with interesting opportunities? And finally, six, culture and heritage. Has the country a vibrant culture? Has it got a strong story to tell? Has it got a well-known cultural heritage? And we've seen archaeological sites. The representative of Honduras was talking about this. And I will show you how Scotland fares in a minute, but keep that in mind. These are the six essential factors which Anholt and the GfK, GfK is the Gesellschaft für Konsumforschung in Nuremberg, and they have a long history of running, for instance, elections, predictions for elections, what the outcome will be. They've got now a sub-branch in New York, and they're working on this from New York, from the New York branch. But they're very reliable in their data. Keith Dinney, I mentioned him before, developed something that he called a category flow model. How do you proceed if you want to do a branding campaign for a country, a region, or a city? The first is anticipation. First, you have to identify all the internal and external perceptions of a nation or a country. That is why most marketing institutes have an international setup, people from all kinds of nations, in order to see how do you feel about that country and how do you feel about it and so on. So what you end up second is what he calls complexity. That is, you get a long, complete list of all characteristics. When I ask my students, when I do nation branding with them, tell me five characteristics of the German nation. Is anybody of you German? Oh, no, never mind. They would say, well, we are on time, we are clean, we are reliable. And you see, if you get these five characteristics, what you get, I said, what you are describing is a machine. That's not a human being at all. You're telling me a machine. You never say anything about warm-hearted, embracing, loving. You know, never do you come up with anything like this. So the idea is, what kind of characteristics would you like to use in the third steps, what is known as cultural expressiveness? Which characteristics are particularly expressive of a nation, of a region? And they must be true. If the nation itself doesn't feel that this is true, then forget it. So it must be something that the people themselves feel, this is how we are, this is who we are, and you can market us with that, because that is what we ourselves believe in. You have then, step four, encapsulated. It says you have to combine these elements in a meaningful way so that a profile of the nation emerges. If you say cold-hearted and loving, that is not a profile, that doesn't work, you know. So for instance, we did it recently for Texas. You know, in Texas, there's a gun culture, which Germans would not. It was for German tourists going to Texas. Texas wanted more tourism. So you wouldn't really use, for Texas, gun culture as a particular characteristic. You wouldn't use capital punishment, death punishment, and wouldn't use that either. You would talk about the golf resorts, you know. So you would try to find a profile that would be attractive to the target community. And finally, you need engagement. You must communicate your profile to the public. the nation brand architecture by measures of printing, television, internet, social media, and if you watch it, for instance, Cyprus is very, very active. We talked about this earlier on. Cyprus is at the moment very, very active in attracting the interest of international communities. So this brings me to my case study. Oh, sorry. But I will make all my transparencies available to you. My first example is Scotland. The brand. It ran for 10 years, as I said earlier on, and it had a logo, as you can see, Scotland's national colour. Scotland's national colour is blue and white, and you see the checked pattern is what is called tartan. Tartan is what you find on kilts, and you've got a tartan pullover, sort of checked tartan pullover. Schottenkabel. None of you is German, so it doesn't matter anyway. It was at the time financed and organized by an association of Scottish business companies. Not the government, it was Scottish businesses who did it. And they were very good. This is early, 1994, it's a very early campaign. They were emphasizing particularly Scottish assets. For example, excellent quality of Scottish products. The attractiveness of Scotland as a tourist destination. The risk-free location of investments, excellent learning opportunities because of a very, very good educational system in Scotland, and a good labor market situation. And they worked on Scotland's strengths. They said, we have four characteristics which are typical of the Scottish nation. Our strengths are integrity, honesty, ingenuity, quality awareness, and independence of spirit. Four characteristics which were supposed to describe the profile of the nation. This is what the Scottish people stood for. It ran for 10 years, and it was successful. And then it was shelved by the government. The government felt this should be the job of politics, not of business companies. So Scotland, the brand, disappeared in 2004. The Scottish government took it over themselves from business. And the criticism was, the campaign was, although it was successful, too traditional, too backward, too much tartanry, too much bagpipes and whiskey, and too little emphasis on Scotland's achievements in the present. It was followed in 2004 by my second example, by a smart, successful Scotland between 2004 and 2007. It's too short. It was again a campaign run by the Scottish government. The subtitle was Ambitions for the Enterprise Networks, which shows already that the government was just going for investments and exports, not for culture, not for people, not for any of the other four items. There was little or no involvement by additional stakeholders. Tourist agencies were not part of the deal. Business companies were left out. Educational institutions like the universities were not roped in, the trade unions, and so on and so forth. It was just a government thing. And as you will see, this is not good. You must have all stakeholders in the boat in order to be really successful. The emphasis at the time was almost exclusively on economic aspects, especially on exports and investments. But when you study the document and other documents that follow, they are full of commonplaces. We are a vibrant place. We are wonderful. You know, it's very, very little of concrete, of precise information that you actually get from these papers. There was no logo. There were very few advertising efforts in the sense of engagement. That is step number five, as I showed earlier on. And parallel to this, the government launched a second campaign. Scotland, the best small country in the world. Yes, that was not original. We had heard that before. That ran for 2 years. And it had not a logo, but it had a little flag. Scotland, the best small country in the world. Launched by the government, at the time a coalition government between Labour Party and Liberal Democrats. And in that document, 40 pages, there's only one sentence that describes the Scottish brand. It's four sentences. This is it. Scotland has a great future. Yeah. We all have. We have one of the best educated workforces in the world, with 50% of our young people going into higher education. Okay. We are world leaders in many modern industries, including financial services, life sciences, oil and gas. We have some of the world's most breathtaking landscapes and a quality of life that is hard to beat. You could take that out for any other country. It is nothing unique at all. It is interchangeable. And of course, I mean, we are world leaders in many modern industries, such as financial services, yeah, banking system. Everybody has got a banking system. Life sciences, yeah, right, biology. Oil and gas, okay. But any precise, would you know any products that come from Scotland? Apart from one, there's a drink. Yeah, there's whiskey. But apart from that, any idea of products that Scotland is so bloody famous for? Yeah, Haggis. So, oh, yeah, Haggis. You must really have a tough bowel in order to stomach Haggis. But I mean, you can't flood the world markets with Haggis, for Christ's sake. Anything else? Iron Brew is a lemonade. It's a lemon. Iron Brew, but only drunk in Scotland. Nobody else wants it. It's so awful. any fabrics? Wool, perhaps. Yes. But did you know that until very recently, every third laptop was made in Scotland? Every third cash machine, where you take money in the bank, every third came from Dumbarton, from what is known as Silicon Glen. But in none of the documents by the Scottish government do you read anything about that sort of output of the Scottish industry. Never, never, ever. And I think that is something where the Scottish government really made a great mistake. So the best small country in the world was criticized. And it was criticized by this jovial, rather jovial gentleman. This is Alex Salmond. At the time, he was still smiling. The campaign, he said, had no logo, no advertising efforts, and Alex Salmond, at the time in 2007, leader of the oppositional Scottish National Party, the SNP, said, it is a campaign which is a terrible blend of obsolete tartanry combined with a frightful inferiority complex. He was in opposition at the time, obviously. Mm-hmm. In 2007, however, there were elections, and the SNP won the elections, and Alex Salmond became the first new minister. And under his guiding hand, the new government, the SNP government, launched a new campaign. This is it. Is that the great breakthrough? Welcome to Scotland. I mean, the former government, now in opposition, had a wonderful time saying, this is better than what we did, yeah? Is that it? And the lesson from it is, you should not give it into government hands. Governments change. You know, the next election, the next government comes on. So the branding campaign must not be tied to the government. It must be tied to some quango or some other institution. In Germany, it's Deutschland Land der Ideen, Germany Land of Ideas. And even if the government changes, that will go on. And the campaign will elaborate on that. But do not bind it to a government. Once a government is voted out of office, the next government wants to do something else. And that is not very good for the branding efforts, especially when you have again the bagpipes playing and you have again tartanry. This is exactly what they didn't want, but this is what they got. So the final campaign was then Scotland's economic strategy. Has been running since 2007 for the past 10 years, and that is sustainable. That is a long-term range campaign. But again, it emphasizes the economy. I mean, there are, as you can see, there are people with a PhD hat indicating the education institutions. There is history, and there are friendly people. But when you look at the documents, it's basically all about the one-sided aspects of the economy. And we learn, investing is a quote, it's a quote from the document, yeah? Investing in our people and our infrastructure in a sustainable way. That's what they want to do. Next step is fostering a culture of innovation and research and development. Third, promoting inclusive growth and creating opportunity through a fair and inclusive jobs market and regional cohesion. And Fourth and finally, promoting Scotland on the international stage to boost our trade and investment, influence and networks. Now just tell me any Western leader who would not subscribe to this. Everybody could have said that. If you take out the word Scotland, Angela Merkel would say, yes, this is also what we are doing. Theresa May would say, yes, exactly, that's what we are doing. It's not really unique for Scotland. It's what Western societies are doing, in which direction they are moving. So let me try to conclude. Nation branding, national identity, national independence. Scotland has been part of the Nation Brand Index, to which I will come in a minute. This is in figure three, how the results of the Nation Brand Index are being visualized. You see here the six factors, people, tourism, immigration, exports, governance, and culture. And you see that the lines for the blue line for 2014 and the red line for 2016 are almost identical. So nothing has changed in the last 2 years. The figures, the dates are exactly the same. And you see this is the 0 point in the middle where there's no rating at all. And you can see where Scotland is rated particularly highly. People is good, tourism is good, culture is bad. Culture is, has a very bad rating. When one looks, and this is just external rating. Other nations have been asked, how do you feel about Scotland? What do you think about Scotland? And these are the results if we look at them by figures. The ranking for Scotland in 2014 and 16, and you see the results in brackets. People, one up from, I have to say, there are 50 nations who are being ranked. And 50 is the lowest, and America is number one at the moment, is the highest. 2 years ago, it was Germany, number one, highest country ranked in the world. Three and four is always Britain and France, they're changing. And five, six, and seven is Sweden, Japan, and Brazil. And I'm wondering what will happen next year in 2017 after Donald Trump. Will the USA be ranked among number one of the best nations in the world? But that would mean that then Germany would take over number one again. But that might explain why so many people would like to come to this country, because it is ranked so highly in almost every respect. So people, one up. Tourism has remained high, 12th place out of 50. Exports gone one up from 22nd place to 21st place. Although the government is putting so much effort into the economy, really, it has made no progress there. Governance, the Scottish government, yes, from 14 to 12 is excellent, is good. Investment and immigration has stayed, 17 has not moved at all. Culture and heritage has improved from 19 to 16. So if one looks at the performance of Scotland in the Nation Brand Index, in the NBI, we get this result. They participate biannually every second year. They started in 2008, then in 2010, 2012, 14, and 2016. And you can see that they've got a rating of 60% when they started, and they're now at 62%, which is 2% up, which is good, which is okay. It's rated the 15th best nation in the world out of 50 from an external point of view, not how the Scots feel themselves. That has changed dramatically, as you will see. So when we look at the figures, it means that Scotland basically is being seen worldwide, globally, as a very interesting country. People know very little about exports, about Scottish products. That's a fault of the government, who did too little in order to market, to brand Scottish governments. But apart from that, Scotland is doing well. So what about the country's competitive identity? What about its strength? The Scottish nation, as we have seen, enjoys a good reputation internally and externally. And since 2008, as we've just seen in the graph, the data have been solid and even slightly improving, 2 points up. Scotland has almost consistently been among the top 20 of the 50 nations who are being ranked in the NBI. The government has been largely successful in promoting the country's assets. But the branding approach, Scotland's economic strategy, has been consistently followed since 2007. You need stamina, a long time, in order to get results. And yet, when you look at certain advertisements like, sorry, the weaknesses, the engagement rests almost inclusively, as I said, by the Scottish government. Other agencies, the universities, the trade unions, they're not really terribly involved. So other stakeholders, as one would say, people who have an interest in Scotland, are not sufficiently involved. The government activities, furthermore, focus on economic issues, but the country does not score well on dimensions like, as we've seen, immigration and investment and exports. Although the government puts so much effort in these particular areas, the results are bad. The Scots are proud of their national culture and heritage, but the score on these two dimensions is also disappointing. So if one looks at an advertisement like this, it's a wonderful scenic photographs of Edinburgh from Calton Hill. You see Edinburgh Castle Hill in the distance, it's wonderful. And it says, looking for a career that inspires, join Team Scotland. But you see it's being run by Visit Scotland. This is the tourist agency. But the tourist agency should not be responsible for getting in the workforce. That is the job of the government. The tourist agency is there to get tourists in. But here the tourist agency apparently takes on the job of the government by saying, come and work with us. That's not their job. You see, it's not really, the entire system is not really synchronized. It's not really quite clear who is doing what in support of the country. But this is external views. If we have a look at the way the Scots themselves feel at the moment, and the results were published 3 weeks ago, that's why I had to rewrite my presentation a bit. Scottish government, this is February 2017, the report came out, and you see here the graph of how the Scottish nation feels at the moment. This is 2010 when rankings began. This is 2012, and this is 2014 when it is highest. This was before the referendum on Scottish independence, when the spirits were high in the country. Everybody thought, we're going to get it, huh? We're going to do it. And the data was collected in June, July. The referendum was in September. So this was just the month before the referendum came along. And you see how the data has collapsed by 2016. These data were collected in July, and the Brexit was in June. So these are the data after how Scotland felt after the Brexit. It's an average decline of 8% in self-perception, how the Scots feel themselves. Some of them go down by more than 11%. This is a catastrophe. What the Scottish government must do now is to bring up the pride in the nation again. They feel lost. You must do something not about how Scotland is seen in the world. You must do something about how the Scots feel themselves, their national pride. And the same was true 2 years ago for Greece. If you have a look at the figures for Greece, the disappointment in Greece about Europe let the figures drop. And this is something that is worthwhile looking at when you would like to understand European nations, how they themselves feel. And I think that is something that Brussels also would have to have a look at. How do we feel? So Scotland is moving between competitive identity and political independence. We have seen the sobering effect of the failed 2014 referendum and of the Brexit in 2016, last year, on Scottish self-perception, and it is difficult to overlook that the Scottish nation has suffered, and their self-esteem must be reworked somehow. The 2014 referendum, I would say, failed for several reasons. The branding strategies were obviously not sufficiently convincing. The economic independence of the country remained questionable. Would Scotland be able to survive economically? Would there be enough money, enough oil and gas, enough fishery? Would it be able to survive? And the proposals of the SNP, of the Scottish National Party, were ludicrous. They wanted to uphold the monarchic order, to keep the Queen as head of state, and I think that is opposed to a civic society, of a democratic society, to keep the Queen. And they wanted to keep the pound instead of the euro. And of course, London said, no, if you go independent, you have your own currency. But if you fail, we're not going to pay for you, obviously. So London said immediately, no, you can't use the pound. But I mean, to say we want to keep the euro, the pound, but we want to become independent is not an expression of sincere commitment to the European idea. I'm sorry about that. So at the moment, again, there is no majority of the electorate in favor of an independent Scotland. And finally, these are the results of the Brexit referendum. And you see England and Wales voting in favor of leaving the EU. You see that Scotland, Northern Ireland and London voted in favor of remaining inside the EU. So what kind of consequences does this get? If we look at the figures in Scotland, 67% voted, remain 62 to remain within the EU. 38 said, no, we're leaving, we want to leave. So if Scotland becomes independent, there's not much left, is there? The idea of Britain will be disappearing entirely. We have little England and a bit of Wales. I don't know if the Irish Republic has said, join us. Northern Ireland, come. Because in our constitution it says we have a claim to the entire island. Come to us and you'll be Europeans. Or do we have now to protect a European frontier on the Irish-Irish border? Does all this IRA business, does all that come back? I mean, I thought we had peace in Northern Ireland, but now if we got a border controls, and what happens if Scotland becomes independent, then there is border controls on the English-Scottish border. And what will happen to London? London said, well, listen, there was a time when West Berlin was part of the EU, surrounded by the GDR. Can't we, as Londoners, be part of the European Union together with Northern Ireland and Scotland and let England and Wales disappear into the darkness somewhere? At the moment, it's rather breathtaking what is going on. So what are then consequences, very, very finally, of the Scottish political independence? Does it spell out the end of the United Kingdom, a union between two kingdoms, the Kingdom of Scotland and England? That would break apart. Would it leave us with little England, consisting of England and Wales? Would there be a union in Ireland, as I said, with the Irish Republic and with Northern Ireland? What about London as a business location? Everybody tried to protect London, every prime minister, because London is just one square mile, 1 mile by a mile. But the turnover is larger than Sweden. London earns more money than Sweden. London earns more money than all the Benelux states taken together. So every prime minister up to now has defended, had to defend London as an economic area. So what will happen to London? And Scottish independence, will it be an incentive for other European regions or nations to lay claim to independence? We've seen Catalonia, the area around Barcelona, they proclaimed their own proclamation of independence 4 years ago. Will they go? What about Northern Italy? What about the Pays Basque? And will this be the end of an architecture that we have become used to, this European architecture? Will it spell out the end of a European of 24 member states? Many of the speakers here before me have, with much more acumen than I have, because they are politicians, expressed this fear that something may happen to the European Union, that it may be really damaged, and this is a very difficult impasse. Scotland is a small nation, as I said at the beginning, and I repeat it at the end, but much will depend on how Scotland decides of its own independence for Britain. Don't let me be the last Queen of Scotland. And this is a Scottish £10 note with the head of Sir Walter Scott, one of the best known Scottish novelists. But either you say goodbye to the Queen and welcome to the Euro, or else I don't think that independence, Scottish independence, really will work. Thank you very much. You've been a very patient audience. Thank you very, very much for sympathy with me.
Thank you very much, Professor Kamm, for your excellent presentation. And if you let us, I would like to invite our audience for question and comment. Yes. Thank you.
I'm not leaving. No. I'm not running away from you. No. Sorry.
Good evening, Professor. This is not to do with Scotland. My question on the not to do with the case study. I just wanted to ask because you are an expert in nation branding. I mean, if we follow the six areas of nation branding that Arnold speaks about, and as an African region and as African
region,
countries,
what region do you represent?
I'm from South Africa.
Oh, yeah.
But I mean, what is synonymous, and what also came out very clearly, I mean, throughout the discussions, what is synonymous with us is corruption, all the negatives. What do we do as a region, and also as, not as a region, as a continent, as regions, and
a state.
Within, what do we do to change that perception of us?
Well, Anhold and others would say you have to start with your own people first. What is the feeling of your people? Who are you? Who are we as South Africans? And could you define a South African identity of the people? What do South Africans stand for? Is there a wonderful lady like you? Yeah. But it must be true. Huh? Thou shalt not lie. otherwise, you can't communicate. If it is not really true, and people don't subscribe it. So if you were to give five characteristics of your people, there are. Yeah, that's very important. That's product. That's product. And good for investment.
So we enjoy our fire. We enjoy.
Yes.
I think we are very diverse.
Tourism?
Tourism, yeah.
You're very good at tourism, aren't you? Oh, I'll switch it off.
Licenses? Banking sector?
Yes. So people, I think we've clarified people, wonderful people.
So we fall short on certain things, which we can probably work on. But the point is, yeah. I mean, things like governance issues.
I remember there was a time 15 years ago when South Africa was the most criminal place on the world. That has changed entirely, hasn't it?
Yeah.
That's something you must communicate to the world, because then you get more tourism, you get more investments, you get more people coming. Is there a branding? I don't know about South. Is there a branding strategy for South Africa?
Yes, I was just asking a general question because I mean that's the perception that's out there, you know, about us, and we have many things that we are doing very well.
Yes, but does the world know? You must tell the world.
Really not if Europe doesn't.
Yeah, some of you must communicate it. You must tell the world what you're wonderful people. You've got wonderful scenery. You've got wonderful beaches. You've got wonderful inland. You've got wine. You've got it all. But you must tell us.
Hello.
Hello.
It's interesting. Maybe this is not a question, actually. It's just a comment. And it's a really bad moment to make comments. But I lived in Scotland in 91. I moved from there in 91. And not much has changed, really, as far as the readiness to be independent. You know, it's all flags and banner when, you know, they talk about the Scottish pride and, you know, that they could do this. But then there's this little piece of lack of confidence, actually, that stops them. And it's still stopping them.
Inferiority complex, I would say.
Exactly.
Were you city-based at the time?
Yeah, Glasgow.
Oh, Glasgow. Oh, yeah. Okay.
Actually, my question is, can we inverse the Brexit? Of course, if Europe and London make a pressure about Scotland and different entities. Thank you.
Yes, can you reverse the Brexit? That is your question. Can you make it and go away unhappening? Well, you see, in Britain, it's not the people who are sovereign, as in this country, Volkssouveränität, but it is Parliament that is sovereign. So Parliament could have said, listen, you told us, yes, but we are the sovereign. We are not going to take this over as our rule. It would have been suicidal for any government not to respect the voice of the people. At the moment, the House of Lords is rejecting the bill in certain parts. It wants it to be revised, especially when it comes to the common market. Tony Blair and other former prime ministers have now lined up in order to make sure that the public was not really properly informed. As we have just heard, that we will suffer, our economy will suffer, the British economy will suffer from exports if they're no longer in the single market. But I think that Theresa May at the moment wants to see it through, a hard Brexit. What will happen in 5 or 10 years? Will Britain again rejoin the EU? Could you imagine that? Saying it was a catastrophe, we're very sorry, please take us back. No, we don't want them back, no.
If it's over, it's over.
Oh, well, that is a marriage, you're talking about. Now, the idea is, I mean, if they really wanted to come back, they would have to take it all, euro, everything that goes with it. There's no special negotiations, then they have to take it all. And I can't see, that is a very brave prime minister to take on the euro in Britain. I can't see that really.
20 years, next generation, you know.
Could well be. You see, I mean, in Britain, for the Brexit, the people who voted for it were the old, the not very well trained, and the rural. And those people who really lost were the young generation, well-trained and urban. And that will be the next generation. But under what conditions, if they really wanted to come back, I mean, you said, no, once it's over, it's over. You know, you don't warm up old relationships. But there may be political reasons the world changes so rapidly these days, it's difficult to say. But if they wanted to come back, then the entire parcel, you know, there's no special negotiations. Take it all or leave it. Abba.
In terms of starting a business in this field, do you think that this is a fertile field in the African market, and how would you go about starting? Thank you.
I'm an Anglicist. I started with Shakespeare. And look where I ended up now. But of course, my expertise in Africa is far too limited to give any advice to Africa. But when you look at the six factors, and what is your country that you represent? Okay, would you say, again, with South Africa, what are your people like? Do you have any interesting products? Anything that you produce? And your dress?
No.
No, it's not from now. because fashion and clothes, that is always good. Yeah? Yeah. And there's always, you know, crossover, you know, Indian, African. So with clothes, you could probably, you know, do something. Music?
Yes.
I remember Miriam Makeba, who lives in Berlin, unfortunately. But African arts, it could be very, very stimulating.
Arts and sculpture.
Yes. Do you have investments in your country?
They all left, but, you know, hopefully. It wouldn't be for now. I know it's a difficult one, but
yeah.
If you look at Keshe, because as you said, it's not a one-year thing.
No.
And, you know, he's 93, he's that.
No.
So, you know, but looking at it, she's crazy, she's on track. So...
I don't think that I have any right to give you any. I'm not really qualified. But when I look at my own country, if you think, I mean, there were two terrible world wars, and Germany was responsible for those wars, and we know that. It took us a long, long time to be where we are today. That people say, well, if you don't lead, who is going to lead? That is something that even in the 1980s we did not really want. We didn't want to be leaders. But if you listen to Stoiber yesterday, he said, who else is going to do it? Italy? France, we don't know what the elections will be, so we probably have to take on the responsibility of leadership, although we don't really like it. But if you think, in 1990, Germany was, the wall came down, and that was difficult for the country. It was expensive, we had two different mentalities to combine, but it took us more than 20 years to be where we are today. So a two-year campaign is a waste of money. Yeah. You must really look at the long, as you were saying, look at 2030. Where would you like to be in 10 years, in 15 years? And what is it that you can do in order to achieve your goals in 10, 15 years? Not next year. That is far too short-sighted, I would think. But I think that Africa has, and we've heard this here, that Africa has the assets, it has the opportunities, but I think that Europe really has to help Africa in order to get on with it. Does that answer? No, it doesn't answer your question. No, I know. I tried my best.
Yeah, yes, my name is Esteban. I am from Barcelona, Spain, or Catalonia, but I'm not going to talk about it.
Well, you're from Catalonia.
Yeah.
Are you in favor of independence?
No, we didn't declare our independence. Well, to be honest, I am not really very patriotic, so I never had this kind of feeling of a nation or something. It's something that I am not really very interested to. But from the outsider or insider as well point of view, at least to have the right to the referendum, because it's ridiculous. You cannot call something democracy when you don't have the right to vote. This is the first thing. But actually, you cannot call it either a democracy when you have a monarchy inside. I mean, they are telling us, yeah, Philip VI is very handsome, is very hot, some people say, is very smart, speaks I don't know how many languages, so... My suggestion is to him, well, if you are so good, why you don't become a candidate for the next elections, right? Because I don't think nobody voted for him, nobody voted for Queen Elizabeth and all these people. So as you can see, I don't really believe in monarchies if we want to speak in democracy. But this is not my topic. What I wanted to ask you, if we have a problem with our power unit in our car, we are going to an engineer or a mechanic, and if we have a headache, we are going to the doctor. I mean, if we have a problem with our car, we don't go to the doctor, and the opposite. When I was living in Finland, I was living in Finland for 1 year. One of the things surprised me, and comparing to what happened in Spain, I don't know other countries, but comparing about the brand, nation branding, you say that every single government wants to put their signature somewhere. It's like in Spain, every with education law. Even the name of the education has the name of the minister. And is never related to education. And I mean that the thing that surprised me more there was that everything related to education, for the reason maybe they have the best educational system in the world, was made by teachers. People from the educational sector. I mean, they are not calling engineers or doctors to do the education laws and the content, because they do the content. And the government check that and approve that. So my first question is, why do you think that every single politician, even that maybe doesn't know anything about this, wants to put their signature? And yeah, basically is that.
You think, well, why the politicians always want to make the decisions?
Why they want to put, even if they don't know what they are doing with that law, or with that, like the field of education, for example, we are talking about, why they want to put their signature in everything?
Well,
I am an advertiser. I'm a journalist and advertiser. I mean, this should be made by people from marketing, advertisement, and public relations, and not by politicians. Politicians, in my opinion, even the minister of a country, should be limited to select the proper people to do. You are going to work in law, you are going to work in education, you are going to go in healthcare, for example. Yeah. Why the people want to put their signature?
I think, point taken, and I've showed you that the bad effects, if the government only runs such a campaign, then the campaign is doomed to fail. Because it's just sort of bound to one particular party. The idea is the best people in that particular field are the tourist agencies, because they've got the professional people. They know how to get the right photographers for the right photography, the right slogans, everything that goes with it. And I think it's the job of the government to say, listen, we push it. Yeah, we push it. But we want to have business companies in it. We want to the universities in it. We want to have the trade unions in it. So all on one round table, and let's see, put our heads together and what is best for our country. But if it is just one party that goes out of office in 2 years' time, then you don't get the sustainable sort of campaign that you want, because it takes you 10, perhaps 20 years in order to move things. But politicians, I think, I'm not a politician, I must say, find it sometimes difficult to share power with others. You've been elected, the people are behind you, you don't want to share your power with others. Ideally. You're still young, you're still optimistic.
No, I mean, some of the people they don't know. I mean, the cousin of my grandfather, maybe everybody knows him, rest in peace, by the way, is the former ambassador from Spain to Moscow and is the former president of the International Olympic Committee, Juan Antonio Samaran.
Ah.
So, being in a family with a little bit inside, at the end, everything is not really very politics. As the president, I don't know if it was Clinton, Bush, economy stupid. Do you remember that sentence? At the end, everything is money. Shall we?
Shall we leave it at that?
Yeah.
Again, thank you very much for your patience and your cooperation.